time. Yeah.
Okay. Very. So I forgot the form that I need to give you. However, Hong Yu asked me just the other day if she could change her account and brought this from her bank. And I'm not sure that this is enough information for you.
Can we wait until after service and I will look at all this? Because she's going to have to fill out a form too.
Okay, all right. Well, okay. I told her.
I've got to have hers by Wednesday. Thank you.
And can I? Send a cell phone picture of it?
You can do that.
Would that work?
Okay. It'd be better than nothing.
Prefer use a hard copy, but
yes.
Okay. All right. So, I just overheard you're moving?
Moving back into town, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I won't be done with the camp. I'll probably go up once a month still, but it's,
yeah,
it's time for somebody else to do the heavy lifting up there.
Yeah.
You know, it's, there's a couple things. I've isolated long enough.
Yeah.
And people are concerned. I was like, I turned 70, magic number. You know, what if you fall down? Well, I don't know how many times I've fallen down.
Yeah. How are the kids?
Oh, great, great. Corinna and Lucius went to Fresno this weekend. It was Al Goodman's memorial service.
Oh.
So, and judging by the radar, they're south of the big rain.
Oh, okay.
So they should be able to fly out and come home tonight.
Okay.
So I've been house sitting for them, which has been interesting. So anyway.
I think we're in.
Excuse me.
All right, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to this service of worship at the Unitarian Universalist Church of Tucson. My name's Wendy Gordon Weeks. I'm part of our worship associates team. Our minister, Reverend Bethany Russell Lowe, is away from the pulpit this week, but she'll be back in the pulpit next Sunday. Today, we have the great pleasure of welcoming our CUPS group to lead our service this morning. If you're not familiar, CUPS stands for the Covenant of Unitarian Universalist Pagans. So please join me in greeting Reverends Julie Olson, Carrie Cooper, Anna Ortiz, and David Foster, who are part of the CUPS leadership. Our community is as varied as the blooms of the Sonoran Desert. Whoever you are, whoever you have been, whoever you are on the path to becoming, I invite you to bring your whole self here now. We are a covenantal community, which means that we make promises about how we are with one another. So in these times of still pandemic lingering, wearing masks while we're in worship and concurrent religious education, and getting vaccinated are all part of our covenant with each other. If you are attending worship in person with us today, our hope is that you are vaccinated as you can be. And if you're unwilling to be vaccinated, you're welcome to join our worship services, but we ask that you join virtually only. I extend a special welcome to visitors and invite you to fill out a guest information card, which Mary Weiss will post in the YouTube chat right now for our friends at home. And there will also be a welcome table at the social hour in Goddard, located out these doors to your left and across the patio. And we invite in-person visitors to go after the service to fill out a yellow guest information sheet. We will meet for social hour right after the service in Goddard for coffee, iced tea, lemonade, some snacks, of course, good company, and everyone's invited to join us. We have a few announcements this morning. The first is our Bible literacy class is going to be meeting today at 12:15 right here in the sanctuary. You're welcome to bring your coffee with you. From Carolyn Saunders and our stewardship team, we're having a small group meeting to discuss goals and aspirations for the church immediately after today's service in awareness, which is that way, if you don't know where it is, someone can help you get there. And if you wish to attend, you're welcome to pick up a snack in Goddard and take it with you. I am really pleased to announce that we are up to $189,000 in our pledge campaign from 79 pledging units. Our goal is $240,000. So if you have not pledged yet, please do so today so your pledge can be counted in the annual campaign. We need everyone to support our church. If you've not done your pledge yet, there's a red and green box right back there next to the kitchen where you can drop your pledge card. If you need a new pledge card, there are some right there with it. And last announcement, our 75th anniversary is coming up in May, and we are going to be putting together t-shirts, and we would love you guys to give us the beautiful art to make those shirts. So if you're creative and you would like to submit a drawing for the shirt, we're asking for those by March 31st. And if you have questions, you can talk to me about that. We're going to start out today with welcoming each other into this space. So please turn to a neighbor, hopefully one you don't know well yet, and tell them something you're anticipating or looking forward to. And if you're joining us online, you're welcome to put your answers in the chat. Thank you. I hope these conversations will continue after the service in Goddard. Welcome. Welcome. Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much. I'm so glad there's so much enthusiasm. So please continue these conversations after this service in Goddard, and welcome again. We're so glad you're with us.
Let us honor the elements and the four directions and invite them to join us as we create sacred space and worship together today. We call to the cool breezes of East as the seasons change. Blow away the stale air of limbo and refresh our spirits. We call to the bright fires of South as the light returns. Rekindle the spark of inspiration and energize us to action. We call to the warm waters of West as the winter ice melts down. Wash us in compassion and kindness and renew our hope. We call to the strong standing stones of North as the frozen ground thaws. Nourish us as life awakens to springtime and lend us your support. Enter our sacred space with your blessings. Bring harmony to this place for the good of all.
It's time for our chalice lighting. We light this chalice today to illuminate our way toward love. Inside the womb of this waiting time, we are bathed in sounds, floating in love, growing out of our comfort zone. We experience love, sorrow, pain, and joy. There is a numinous quickening as we await a new world yet unborn.
Test, test. Our first song today has four parts to it, and each of the parts sounds good with any of the other parts. So I'm going to sing through them, and I'm going to sing through each part twice, and I invite you to linger at any point on any line that speaks to you for as long as you choose. Eventually, I'm going to come back to the one that begins mystery and will end in mystery. Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Where do we come from? Where do we come from? Mystery, mystery. Life is a riddle and a mystery. Mystery, mystery. Life is a riddle and a mystery. Where do we come from? Where are we going? Where do we come from? Where are we going? Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Where do we come from? Where do we come from? Mystery, mystery. Life is a riddle and a mystery. Mystery, mystery. Life is a riddle and a mystery. Where do we come from? Where are we going? Where do we come from? Where are we going? Mystery, mystery. Life is a riddle and a mystery. Louder. Mystery, mystery. Life is a riddle. And softer. Mystery, mystery. Life is a riddle and a mystery. Softer still. Mystery, mystery. Life is a riddle and a mystery.
Our first reading this morning is the poem Song by Wendell Berry. Within the circles of our lives, we dance the circles of the years, the circles of the seasons within the circles of the years, the cycles of the moon within the cycles of the season, the circles of our reasons within the cycles of the moon. Again, again, we come and go, changed, changing. Hands join, unjoin in love and fear, grief and joy. The circles turn, each giving into each, into all. Only music keeps us here, each by all the others held. In the hold of hands and eyes, we turn in pairs, that joining, joining each to all again. And then we turn aside, alone, out of the sunlight, gone, into the darker circles of return.
Pat Zetlow Miller, illustrated by Annie Wilsdorf. One bright fall day, Sophie chose a squash at the farmer's market. Her parents planned to serve it for supper, but Sophie had other ideas. It was just the right size to hold in her arms, just the right size to bounce on her knee, just the right size to love. "I'm glad we met," Sophie whispered. "Good friends are hard to find." At home, Sophie used markers to give her squash a face. Then she wrapped it in a blanket and rocked it to sleep. When it was time to make supper, Sophie's mother looked at the squash. She looked at Sophie. "I call her Bernice," Sophie said. "I'll call for a pizza," said her mother. After that, Bernice went everywhere with Sophie, to story time at the library, to visit other squash at the farmer's market, to practice somersaults by the garden. Every night, Sophie gave Bernice a bottle, a hug, and a kiss. "Well, we did hope she'd love vegetables," Sophie's mother told her father. "Shh," Sophie said, "Bernice is sleeping." "Sweet pea," Sophie's mother said one morning as they made blueberry waffles. "Bernice is a squash, not a friend. If we don't eat her soon, she'll get mushy and gross. Let's bake her with marshmallows. Won't that taste yummy?" "Don't listen, Bernice," Sophie cried. That afternoon, Sophie's father took her shopping. "Sugar beet," he said. "Bernice is a squash. Why don't you pick a nice toy to play with instead?" But the trucks were too hard and the dolls were too soft. Sophie clutched Bernice tightly. "No thanks," she said. "I have everything I need." After supper, Sophie's parents called a family meeting. Bernice napped in Sophie's lap. "Why don't we donate Bernice to the food pantry before she rots?" her father suggested. Sophie shook her head. "Bernice will last forever." "Bernice seems a little blotchy," said Sophie's dad on the way to the library one day. "She looks perfect to me," Sophie replied. At story time, some kids pointed and stared. "What's that spotty thing?" a boy asked. "Her name is Bernice and she's a squash," Sophie said, "with freckles." "Maybe Bernice should stay home next time," Sophie's mom suggested. "Why?" Sophie asked. "She wasn't the one being rude." Still, as winter neared, Sophie noticed changes. Bernice seemed softer, and her somersaults lacked their usual style. "Visiting friends will cheer you up," Sophie said. At the farmer's market, squash were everywhere. Firm, shiny squash. "What keeps a squash healthy?" Sophie asked a farmer. "Well, it's simple, really," he said. "Fresh air, good clean dirt, a little love." "Well," Sophie thought, "I have all that." At home, Sophie cleared leaves from Bernice's favorite spot. She made a bed of soft soil, tucked Bernice in, and kissed her goodnight. "Get better soon," she whispered. That night, while Sophie slept, the wind whistled and tiny snowflakes fell. When she awoke, the world was covered in white. "Do you think Bernice is cold out there?" Sophie asked her mother. "I'm sure she's warm and cozy under her snow blanket," her mother replied. Sophie gazed out the window all morning. She was still there in the afternoon when her father came home with a surprise. "You need a new friend," he said. "Meet Ace." Ace was nice, but boring. He just swam around and around in his bowl. But during the long winter, Sophie discovered that Ace was a superb silent reader who did fabulous flip turns, and he always listened politely when she talked about Bernice. When the snow finally melted, Sophie rushed to the garden. The only thing there was a small green sprout. It looked strangely familiar. "Bernice," Sophie said, "how was your winter?" After that, Sophie, Ace, and Bernice ate lunch together every day. One bright summer morning, Sophie somersaulted across her yard, landed by the garden, and stared in disbelief. Bernice had grown two tiny squash. "Wow," Sophie told them, "you look just like your mom." Soon, Bonnie and Baxter were just the right size for Sophie to hold in her arms and bounce on her knee. Just the right size to love.
My name's Frank. Part of my remarks are about letting your light shine. I rarely tell jokes in public, so I thought I would try and start with an adaptation of an old Chinese story. A UU church was terrorized by a demon. The demon attacked people, took all the coffee and snacks, screamed during service, broke the chalice, intentionally sang out of key, and was a real nuisance. The congregation tried everything they could to get rid of it, but to no avail. Finally, the board of trustees went to the minister, begging for her to do something. The minister said, "No problem, go home and rest easy, because tomorrow morning I'll send someone to take care of the problem." Next morning, the congregation was eagerly waiting for something dramatic like a SWAT team. But what they saw was a single elderly committee member coming into the sanctuary humming a song. They asked, "Where are you going?" She said, "The minister told me to come take care of the problem." "Are you sure? This is a terrifying demon, mighty beyond words. We are helpless against it." "No problem," said the woman, and entered the sanctuary. Within moments, the congregants heard blood-curdling screams. The sanctuary rattled and shook. Within moments, the demon shot through the roof, screaming and howling, and disappeared into the distance. The unruffled woman came out with a thin smile on her lips. The congregants fell to their knees in thanks and apologizing for not believing that she could do anything. "How did you do it?" The woman answered, "Simple. I'm from the stewardship committee. And I reached into my bag and pulled out a pledge form." Of course, there's nothing scary about pledging. Carol and I have been doing it for decades. A couple of Sundays ago, Reverend Bethany referred to our mission. We transform ourselves, our community, and our world by living our UU values. This led me to think how this applies to me. In the interest of time, I'll only talk about how I've been transformed. Before coming to UUCT, I didn't think there was a church or a religion compatible with my worldview, as well as rejecting metaphysical things and dogma like, if you don't believe in this particular thing, you'll go to hell. At the time, and even now, I was alarmed by the growing political power behind being wielded by the fundamentalist religions, especially conservative Christian denominations. This seemed to be a fundamental change from the earlier social conventions of politics is about the people and religion is about your personal ethics. I wish there was a religious counter to this that I could support, but I didn't think there was anything out there. Though this was on my mind, I came to UUCT for the same prosaic reason many of you did, looking for a liberal education, religious education for my son, who was 2 at the time, and yesterday he was turned 35. My biggest story of personal transformation is when I stepped forward to volunteer as president of this congregation because of concerns about what was going on at the time. It was out of character for me, since during my school years, I had come to learn to hide my light and stay in the background as much as possible. I didn't know what to expect. Besides the many challenges that we're facing that I helped address, such as transforming our finances, transforming our governance, transforming our community, I learned how to bring people together to listen and how to find the change that people could agree on. I'm not the same person I was before coming to UCT. I better understand my values, and it is okay to accept my intuitive love of science as being an aspect of that scary term, spirituality. And I'm more willing to take the risk of letting my light shine. For these reasons and many more, transform yourself, our church and community, and our world by letting your light shine and giving of your time, talent, and treasure. Now, an offering will be collected to support the life and work of our congregation. If you're joining us online on YouTube, You can send a check to the office, give online at uuctucson.org/donate, or text 833-363-5796. If you are here in person, the ushers will come around and take an offering. Thank you.
It is time for joys and sorrows. Our earth is strong. It can hold our pain and our joy, our love and our anger. Our shared bowl, which we use for joys and concerns each week, is strong enough to hold the big rocks, our collective celebrations and mournings, and also the smaller stones that will be added to signify our individual joys and sorrows. The collective sorrows on my heart and mind this week. Personally, I'm still feeling the war in Ukraine, the escalating war against transgender people in this country, and the joy of the seasons turning, getting out of the cold, and the joy of this congregation celebrating 75 years. It's good to be here with you all today. We who live in the desert know that water is a life-sustaining and scarce resource. Let's remember those who are walking through our desert right now without access to water. We pour water from a plastic jug, similar to the ones used by those seeking to assure greater access to water in the desert, like our ministry partner, No More Deaths. For those of you who are joining us virtually, if you have a joy or sorrow to share, I invite you to type it into the chat or speak it out loud wherever you are. If you are here in person, you are welcome to come up to the table now and put a stone into the water to symbolize your joy or your sorrow. The pebbles create ripples of hope and healing. And I will place one pebble in the bowl for the unspoken joys and the unspoken sorrows that we are experiencing together.
Thank you. Each Breath by Leif Seligman. We pause in the stillness to rest for a moment, to quiet ourselves so that we can feel what stirs within us. Each breath draws us closer to the pulse of life, and with each exhalation, we make room for something new. We may find in this gathering the comfort of those who care. May we encounter patience along with our growing edges and compassion in our most tender spots. Here we may find the inspiration and encouragement we need to face our challenges and nurture ourselves. And in the presence of suffering across the globe, may we redouble our efforts to practice kindness where we are, with the hope that the light of our actions travels like light of faraway stars. May our gestures of compassion and generosity seed possibility. May we travel humbly with one another, choosing reconciliation over resentment as we try to live right-sized. When life presses in and shifts us off balance, when pain assails us, when frustration mounts, may the rhythm of our breath steady us and bring us back to a place of gratitude.
Our second reading today is from Contares by Antonio Machado, translated by our own Reverend Anna. Everything passes away and everything remains. But it is our lot to pass making roads. Roads that lead over the seas. I never pursued glory or to leave in the memory of men my song. But I love the delicate worlds, weightless and graceful like soap bubbles. I like to see them paint themselves in blue and scarlet as they fly, and beneath the blue sky tremble suddenly and burst. Traveler, your footsteps make up the road and nothing else. Traveler, there is no road. One makes the road by walking. By walking, one makes the road. And when you turn and look back, you see the path that will never be stepped upon again. Traveler, there is no road, but the wakes breaking upon the sea.
So you have either successfully made your journey here to 22nd Street or found us on YouTube. Travel is one of our most common analogies for life. We are all just walking each other home, affirmed the great spiritual teacher Ram Dass. In the earlier reading from Antonio Machado, we are walkers trying to carve out a new path for ourselves, an original path going through the world. Sometimes life is the river in which we are drifting towards the sea, and of course, there is the maxim. It's the journey, not the destination. This analogy may have seemed quaint and comforting before the apocalyptically crowded superhighway of modern capitalism, which I have described in my own poetry as our punch-carded races towards a goal that vomits tears and cash. Indeed, we seem to all have signed up for one of those ambitious tours where we will check off the great cities of Europe in one weekend while herding cats.
And then the journey seems to have as many interminable pauses, intermissions, and repetitions as it holds revelations or achievements. We are always waiting, frustrated, exhausted. Yet we notice this more as adulthood tries to set in. I may have been a bold adventurer in my 20s, but now my jukebox favorites seem to be "The Waiting is the Hardest Part" and "Stop the World, I Want to Get Off." Today, we are celebrating the in-between times and places. Most pagan and indigenous spiritual traditions value this entry into the indeterminate, the becoming spaces. In our Sazcups rituals, which roughly follow the wheel of the year, we accompany each other to the reality of the space between the worlds and mark our time together as distinct from the ordinary and profane. But we are failed sometimes by overdrawing this distinction between the special and the everyday. Increasingly, what we desperately need is the ability to shift our experience of the tedious, the stressful, the moments when nothing positive seems to be happening. And today, we hold up the moments of rest stop, of anticipation, when the beach sand is waiting for the ocean wave to return. We marvel at our great transformations in the egg of the womb and the egg of the grave. We are watching our pot on the stove, insisting that this is part of the boiling. Just now, science is confirming the necessity of the in-between, the role played by sleep and dreams in health and problem solving and creativity. There is never an absence of becoming. Physicists just discovered that even in a vacuum emptied of matter, the universe insists on changing energy into stuff. And rather than holding up the greyhound of buses or the tigers in our tanks as our animal totems, maybe we need to elevate the axolotl, the forever immature Mexican smiling amphibian whose very in-betweenness holds properties of healing and regeneration. So please, get comfortable in your seats. Feel your feet grounding you upon the earth. Let your worries roll off of your shoulders. Close your eyes and join me in breathing together three times as we experience the spiritual practice of getting off the highway of life, of reaching for the refreshments and rest that we need to continue making our path. Breathe in slowly, bringing in the currents of rest, of openness, of curiosity, and breathe out, feeling your tensions and anxiety and worries dissolve into the great universe. Again, breathe in, feeling the transforming oxygen and nitrogen, the way that it comes into your cells. And breathe out, expelling good intentions, stillness, quiet. And finally, a last time, breathe in, quietly feeling light come into your entire self and feeling purpose and peace come out through your feet. Now, imagine yourself after the long hours of a road trip, which has been all stop and go. You and everyone in your vehicle are tired, hungry, and have to go to the restroom. The windows are closed to keep out the stench of the traffic, and roadside attractions have been limited to terse and uninformative highway markers. There's a sign suddenly indicating a way out of this tiring stretch of road, at least temporarily. You have arrived at the exit for the rest stop. This is not like the rest stop on I-10 between New Mexico and Arizona, where you have to watch out for rattlesnakes, or like the sketchy isolated rest areas that feel unsafe, or the service station restrooms where you have to ask for a key. Here, there are vending machines that accept whatever you have to offer and dispense everything from snacks to naps to the courage to make hard phone calls and new ways to solve old problems. Guilty pleasures are on the menus and on the televisions. Here, there are no cold trucker showers. Baths, private and communal, have your most treasured skin and hair products. The rooms available for naps seem familiar, but they are spacious enough for dancing, for dreaming, and for sharing stories next to a lit fireplace. Pets are welcome, but they are not the only flying or four-footed friends accompanying you. Hummingbirds, ground squirrels, butterflies, and desert tortoises all frequent the wooden picnic area of the rear of the complex. The rest stop library has that one volume of a series that you have never been able to find elsewhere. Everyone is fully vaccinated and wearing masks, and you know everyone you meet is quietly smiling. Every room seems to have something that you have been missing to feel fully yourself. Childhood swing sets, crayons, the sound of a grandparent's voice, the best cups of tea, chilled water from a clean spring, oxygen, company, and solitude, all in abundance. There is nothing you need to deserve this. It does not matter if you don't get back on the road to race to your next milepost. You didn't have to plan it perfectly, and you don't need to know where you are headed. Over the next few minutes, get to know this place, the special remedies and supports that wait for you there. Be bold, be childlike, be open. Is something glorious germinating under the disguise of the ordinary? Take your time going through the rooms until you find a token that will return you safely and reliably to the resources of the rest stop when you need them again. Perhaps it's an affirmation, or a song, or a pattern of centering breathing. Feel your treasure. Memorize its weight in your hands, the free feeling it deposits in your bones, how it drains the tension from your neck and shoulders. I ask that you place that token in a location you can return to and retrieve it, perhaps a room or locker or chest. Take some time now to thank the presences of assistance and recovery that have been available to you. In a bit, we will step back into ordinary time and space, but we are not the same as when we entered. We can always access the in-between, the liminal. We can always value the places that our society deems wasteful and unproductive. They are our oases in the desert of faster and never enough. When the road is hard, we know that our suffering will pass and the difficulties will breed compassion. When the journey is joyful, we know that those moments will also pass and we will be more attentive to beauty, wonder, and kindness. When you are ready, open your eyes and return to this room. What we want to do now is affirm and anchor the values of rest, recovery, and patience into our everyday lives. In the front of the sanctuary, we have a special paper for you to write down what is, for you, the gift that you will commit to give yourself, and by extension to your fellow sentient beings. We have the three bowls in the front, and the ushers, two in the front, one in the back, and you can raise your hand for ushers to bring you a paper and the pencil. And we have a slide with some suggestions, and of course, you know what would bring you the greatest benefit. Your action of writing is an action of setting intention. The bowls of water, tended by Carrie and David and Julie, are where you can place your intention so that it dissolves into the unfolding of the universe. And if you are watching this service from your home, you have a few options for how you can place this gift into becoming. You can do so, if you can do so safely, you can light a small candle to mark your desire. In my home, we write what we want to experience in our lives on a small piece of paper and place it under a goblet for a water goblet for 3 days. The specific action is not as important as understanding how the ostensibly trivial comforts and wasted time benefit our spiritual lives. So here are the examples, and I confess that they are tilted towards what I personally find restful. Extra long and bubbly bath. Dance like no one is watching when people are. Quiet time with an animal companion. Watch childhood cartoons. Stand and breathe in moonlight. Karaoke or avoiding karaoke. Bowling also works in that capacity. Coloring books or sending greeting cards to soldiers or prisoners. So these are some of the things that you can choose. And finally, as you get ready to write your papers, between the worlds, there is always enough. So by granting other travelers rest, we accumulated ourselves.
This song, I think, is new to maybe many of you, but it's short and easy to learn. So as you pick it up, then you're welcome to join in, and we will do a little bit of a round once we get it together under all of us. So go to the very edge where the old world ends and something else begins. Something else begins. Go to the very edge where the old world ends and something else begins. Something else begins. Go to the very edge.
Go to the very edge.
The old world
ends. Where the old world ends.
And something else begins. Something else begins.
Something else begins.
Go to the very end.
Go to the very end.
Where the old world
ends. Where the old world ends.
And something else begins.
And something else begins.
Something else begins.
Something else.
Go to the very end.
Go to the very end.
The old world
ends. The old world ends.
And something else begins.
And something else begins.
Something else.
Something else.
Something else begins.
Please join me in our chalice extinguishing words from Reverend Kevin Jago. When the candle dims, when the wax almost spent, the light turns amber like a sunset. Still, it provides light. Still, it provides heat. Still, it can kindle new flame and pass its glow on and contribute to new illumination. When sunsets turn to new days, when seasons transform all, when the candle dims, all is not lost. Hope continues, uncertain and true, like candlelight ready to spark again. All is not lost.
Closing reading today is adapted from a chalice lighting for liminal times, but we've adapted it for ending, by Summer Elbeate. In betwixt and in between, we move in the liminal spaces that show shades of what can become, of what can be. We leave this place with the courage to move into that time of this and that, and not this and not that, with patience and faith and love and hope that this time will pass, like the sun that moves between the rising and the setting, reminding us that beauty resounds in betwixt and in between.